Welcome to Discovery Watch with John Kaiser.
I'm your host, Jim Goddard. Welcome back to the show, John.
Jim, it's a pleasure to be back on what was a very rough day.
John, FPX Nickel just announced that it's going ahead with an updated PEA, even though nickel prices have dropped below $6 a pound in the wake of China's coronavirus-related slowdown. Wouldn't it make sense to wait for this fuss to blow over?
Well, Jim, this has been a bad week for the resource juniors because investors finally started getting the message that economic problems unleashed by all the quarantines in China are going to affect the bottom line of companies around the world thanks to the supply chain disruption. So we've seen the big equity markets start to pull back, and today was a particularly bad day. I think almost 1,200 points down for the Dow. After yesterday, a report that a person in California was found to have the coronavirus, and there is nobody that they can tell that this person was in contact with who might have been infected. So this means that the virus has arrived in Fortress America, and there's nothing Prince Prospero can do about it. So the panic is now spreading all over the place, and it's being manifested in the market, because if we have these sorts of quarantine disruptions start to happen in the United States, well, that will really put a big damper on the global slowdown. Now, the Chinese situation is probably starting to get under control, and the hysteria about this virus is considerably overblown, because the chances of getting it are less than 1 in 500. And I like to make bets for 500 to 1 returns on juniors, but I don't seem to ever have that sort of the success. It's kind of what we at Discovery Watch happen, and we're still waiting for it to happen. There's also a lot of hand-wringing about the PDAC, also known as the PDAC conference in Toronto. Should we bail? Is it going to be this terrible sharing of germs from around the world as miners and explorers all gather together and shake hands and drink lots of beer? And some people are, in fact, starting to bail, but most of this crowd is heading over there. I'm heading over there this weekend, I may refrain from shaking people's hands, but I'm not going to be worried about catching this virus. It's still way too early to worry about catching this virus. It isn't dispersed enough. But from the perspective of a company like FPX Nickel, who published a PEA back in 2013, which suggested they needed $9 a pound a nickel for the Dakar project in central British Columbia to be viable, it does seem strange timing that they would do an updated PEA now, when we can expect at a minimum further economic disruption and weak metal prices. But there's an important reason why they have decided to go ahead with this. They've done all the sort of physical work needed to considerably upgrade the resource, that they have an optimized ore schedule rather than the run-of-mine average used by Cliffs back in 2013. They've done a lot of work with the flow sheet to make that a much better concentrate. Instead of 12%, it's a 65% nickel concentrate. And they've also managed to demonstrate that they can make nickel sulfate from this concentrate through basic solvent extraction, which opens up additional market beyond the stainless steel mills for this product that they are going to produce from this unusual project. So they think they have really improved the economics. But the potential strategic partners out there, they don't want to just have hearsay from the company on some, under some confidentiality agreement. They want to see a qualified professional sign off on a 43-101 PEA. So the company's really engaging in what they call economic discovery, which is about discovering the costs to operate this nickel mine. And it won't be in production for 5 to 7 years from now, and who knows what the nickel price will be then, you know, assuming that the world doesn't curl up and disappear in the meantime. It'll probably be a much bigger economy, and the nickel supply situation will be very different. In fact, one of the concerns about near-term negative pressure on nickel prices has already been sort of put off for a bit. In Indonesia, they've got $11 billion worth of HPAL and nickel pig iron smelter facilities under construction, which will eventually allow Indonesia to come back as a major supplier of nickel. But with all the disruptions, they've panicked and stopped construction on these projects. So who knows how long it will take for all of this new nickel supply to come back. On stream. And the company also announced that they're doing $1.5 million financing, no warrants, at 18 cents. I talked to Martin Turan, and he says, yep, this is going to be done. It's just because the stock's at 16 cents today. We're not going to change the price. It'll give us with about $2.4 million, only a portion of which we need for this PEA, which we hope to have out in September or October. And it will show the world what our cost structure is. And then the big guys, they have their own ideas of what the nickel price will be down the road. They want to know what are the cost numbers, and those are not really going to change much at all, unless we're in an inflationary environment, in which case the price of nickel will also go up. They want to see what does it cost to produce nickel from the car. And they decided, well, there's no point waiting for the perfect nickel price so that one can sort of guess, oh yeah, this is going to be robust. It'll be a $2 billion CapEx project. So they're going to need an NPV of at least $1 billion to make this worth developing. What nickel price is needed to achieve that? Well, that PEA will tell the world. And the company right now is still being priced as though it takes $9 a pound or higher for nickel for this project to be viable. So they're biting the bullet. They're going to do this, and this will be a very positive development for this company, which continues to be priced as though what was figured out in 2013 is still the reality today.
We'll have more with John Sorry, my lips stuck together. We'll have more with John Kaiser right after this.
Media recognition from Bloomberg, Reuters, recycling trade publications. Patented process for 100% recovery of critical metals, including cobalt, lithium, nickel, manganese, aluminum. American Manganese is focused on recycling lithium-ion batteries for electric vehicles. American Manganese trades on the TSX Venture, AMY, the U.S., AMYZF, and Frankfurt 2AM. For more information, visit AmericanManganeseInc.com or phone me, Larry Ray, at 778-574-4444.
Avon Resources Limited is a gold exploration company with significant projects in British Columbia and the Yukon. Trading on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol ABN, and the OTCQB, symbol ABNAF. Surrounded by world-class gold deposits and mines, Avon's 23,000 hectares Forest Kerr Gold Project is located in the heart of the Golden Triangle in northwestern BC. For more information, visit us at avonresources.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with John Kaiser. John, Forum Energy Metals announced that Rio Tinto has halfway completed a winter road to Janus Lake. What does that mean?
Well, Jim, I had Forum Energy as a bottom fish spec value rated company in my portfolio last year. But at the end of the year, I elevated to one of my 2020 favorites. And the reason was because I found out that paperwork had been filed in northern Saskatchewan for permitting a winter road about 99 kilometers, a spur off a main road that would enable Rio Tinto to deliver what we now know is to be an 80-person camp, 3 core rigs, and a rotary air blast drill, plus lots and lots of fuel. And it was a concern last year because last year they spent over $3 million, which was their first 18-month commitment at Janus Lake, which is a sort of a copper-silver sediment-hosted play, which Rio Tinto appears to think has world-class potential. They own like over 50 kilometers of strike, but most of the drilling was just focused on a fairly small area near Janus Lake testing zones that were already identified by Forum and previous operators. And the question everybody had is, did they see what they wanted to see to confirm their models about the district potential of this region? And they didn't really tell Forum anything, but they did start this paperwork. And in, on January 21st, Forum told us that the permit was received. So this winter road has been under construction since then, and it's halfway done. And there's still an outside chance that the weather warms really early up there and that they can't get it done and all the equipment moved in. But right now it looks on track for Rio Tinto being able to move all this equipment into there. And the signal that this tells us is that Rio Tinto likes what it sees. The next stage involves spending $7 million by 2023 to earn 51%, at which point they can make a decision to go to 80% by spending another $20 million. I wouldn't be surprised if they blow through a good chunk of that $7 million today, assuming that we don't have some bad luck in the form of an early spring up there. So this was a very positive development. And the reason it's particularly important to Forum is the company has only a small amount of money. But last year, they staked in that same region up there, the Love Lake project, which is a platinum palladium group play. It's in the Swan River complex, which is the second largest ultramafic complex in North America after the Duluth complex. That's part of the mid-continent rift that straddles, you know, Minnesota and Ontario. And right now we have a palladium boom. Palladium's bouncing around between $2,600 and $2,700 an ounce. Platinum has sagged down to $900 an ounce. There's several drivers for this change. The first is that the Volkswagen's diesel emission cheating scandal has created a backlash against diesel car engines, and platinum is the key input for catalytic converters for the diesel engines, whereas palladium is what goes into the catalytic converters for gasoline-powered engines. So all of a sudden, there's been a shift of demand away from platinum to palladium. Then on top of that, the Russian nickel mine Norilsk, which is the most important palladium producer, it's undergoing an expansion which involves a disruption of output. So you have had a decline of palladium output. And then the third thing that's happening is Europe has higher emission standards for their gasoline powered engines, which means an additional a boost in demand for palladium. So now you have this perfect storm of supply that cannot be increased substantially. The South African mines, the platinum's a higher grade than the palladium, so they can't really boost that. So we've got these crazy high prices, which will probably last for a couple years, unless, of course, our coronavirus crisis causes a severe global slowdown and car parts stop coming from China, and we have demand for, you know, the catalytic converters for sales that aren't happening because the cars aren't being produced, drop the price down. But I suspect the price pullback would be still $1,500 to $2,000 an ounce. And that's still very important for the potential economics of these plays. So Love Lake, Forum staked it because they knew there were all these platinum palladium values that have been prospected. Another company, Canadian Platinum, had done a bunch of work in the past decade, but never really found anything. But they liked this Love Lake Pluton at the southern end. And so last summer they spent a couple hundred grand sending Jim Atkinson and Larry Halbert into the field, and they did detailed mapping of it, sampling of it, and basically did a lot of deep thinking about it and came to the conclusion that this intrusion is still intact in its original form. And this is really important because there's three types of platinum palladium bearing deposits that form in these systems. There's the Voisey's Bay style, magmatic segregation feeders, where you have the heavy sulfide settling down to the bottom of the magma chamber, where the you know, it's still being fed hot, fresh magma, and it ends up piling into these feeder vents and also all around it. And so that's what the Voisey's Bay Ovoid is all about. These tend to be massive sulfide nickel copper deposits with a platinum palladium credits. Then there's the Bushveld style reefs, which form higher up in the layered intrusive, and those are, you know, not very thick, maybe a couple of meters thick, but they are quite enriched in platinum and palladium, and they're very laterally extensive. And then there's the third type, the Lac des Iles type, where there are structures within the cooling intrusion which continue to be the sort of vent for magmas coming up. And under the right conditions, it forms these disseminated platinum palladium deposits that if they're near surface, can be open pit mined like Lac des Iles itself. So they now see the potential for all three styles of these deposits, and they would like to do a $600,000 program this summer. And getting this Rio Tinto thing happening, where, wow, this is serious. Janus Lake's going to see work for at least another year, and if it might even deliver something much richer than has been the focus at Janus Lake, because that's where it happened to outcrop, and that's where historical work was done. When they start using what they learned from the geophysics in those known zone areas and start testing targets along the 50-kilometer strike, who knows what fabulous discoveries might come out of that. So that just might make audiences braver about putting money into Forum to fund a program at Love Lake. And the first will be a $300,000 magnetic survey on 100-meter spacing so that they can see the third dimension of the Love Lake Pluton much better. And then they're going to do a lot of surface sampling for another couple $100,000. And what they hope to learn from the surface geochemistry is where we are in the erosion history of this intrusive complex. Are we still very much high up so that these magmatic segregation type Voisey's Bay deposits are going to be way too deep to ever intersect, or even these reef systems are going to be like 1,000 meters deep so that you blow your brains out trying to hit them? I mean, once you hit them, they're going to be laterally extensive. You have a discovery. So the models of the geochemistry of these layered intrusive systems are reasonably well understood, and the company is going to do a lot of sampling so that they can say, okay, here's the sort of targets that are reasonable for a little junior to tackle. The Lac des Iles potential in the eastern part of the Pluton, there they already have high-grade values at surface, so the geophysics will help them perhaps identify some low-hanging fruit targets in this area. As in terms of discovery, not going to happen until the final quarter of this year. They won't be in a position to drill. But nevertheless, between Janus Lake and the Love Lake play and the growing interest in platinum palladium systems, there's a lot of interest in the systems that have already been established in Canada, United States, that are kind of low-grade, and everybody's hoping that high palladium prices are going to be part of the future. That probably won't be the case, but something lower and making a brand new discovery that's got the grades that work at considerably lower prices, the Love Lake Pluton is the right place to be. So the news was actually, although it didn't seem very interesting, it was actually very significant and raises the chances that Forum can raise the capital to go into Love Lake this summer and perhaps have two significant discoveries at the end of the year.
We'll have more with John Kaiser right after this.
Engineer Gold Mines is focused on the exploration and development of the historic high-grade Engineer Gold Mine situated 32 kilometers southwest of Atlin, British Columbia. Engineer Gold Mines is fully permitted for surface and underground exploration with the drill program now underway. Engineer Gold Mines Limited trades on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol EAU. For more information, please visit us at engineergoldmines.com.
Cypress Development Corp is developing a world-class lithium resource in the heart of Clayton Valley, Nevada. The size of the resource makes the Clayton Valley project a premier asset with the potential to impact the future of lithium supply. Cypress Development Corp trades on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol CYP, the OTCQB, symbol CYDVF, and on Frankfurt, symbol C1Z1. For more information, please visit our website, cypressdevelopmentcorp.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with John Kaiser. John, last week, New Legacy Gold released results for last year's drilling at the Red Hill project in Nevada. Do we have a discovery?
Jim, we do not yet have a discovery. And this program really only had one chance at making a significant discovery. One of the holes was drilled in the western part of the Red Hill project into what they call the 4-mile lookalike target. And this whole area west of the Iceberg and Serena area where they've spent, you know, $24 million since 2012, it is covered by a veneer of basalt and volcanics, both of them younger than the window during which Carlin-type deposits formed. Unfortunately, technical drilling difficulties prevented them from getting through that cover rock into the area where they think there is a Wenban 5, contorted into a sort of 4-mile lookalike configuration. And if that it got down there, well, maybe if it is like 4 Mile, which is a very high grade gold discovery that's quite deep and it's north of the Gold Rush deposit, well, that would have been a discovery. The other four holes were drilled east of what they call the rift anticline in the sort of western slope and Serena offset target. And one of them achieved a decent interval of about 5.2 meters of 9.6 gram per ton. But it's in a geological context where there is no real size development potential. The other two, three holes didn't really hit anything interesting. One went into the Wenban 4 and didn't get through that. But this Wenban 5 intersection is important because it is the key to the new discovery model that Ed Cope, Charles Wheatley, and the rest of the ex-Barrick team who moved to a new legacy in 2017-2018 have developed based on very detailed re-logging of all the holes that have been drilled in the Iceberg and Serena offset area. And these guys, they know the Gold Rush system inside out. And they know that at Gold Rush, which is a 5 kilometer long deposit, the 300-400 meters wide and 50 to 70 meters thick, and it averages 10 grams per ton gold. It's a 10 million ounce deposit that's going to go into production at 450,000 ounces a year in 2021 with about a 610 all-in sustaining cost of meaning that, you know, at the current gold price, this thing will be a huge, huge money spinner. Well, it's created by these low angle faults coming from the west, intersecting high angle faults. And where this happens inside the Wenban 5 horizon, which is one of 8 horizons in the Wenban formation, which are all these limestone rocks, Wenban 5 is the one that's got just the right level of dirtiness that makes it the ideal sponge for the gold mineralization. And that's what is the case at 4 Mile. It's the case at Gold Rush. And they identified this in that Iceberg area and realized, well, the gold is in here, but what we have here in the east is like just the remnants of a gold system. They call it an exhaust plume from something that came in from the west. Now, unfortunately, to the west, everything is covered by these younger garbage rocks, and nobody likes to drill blind. But these guys have been doing these CSAMT surveys, which have been done over the area where they have $24 million worth of data about what the geology looks like in the third dimension. And they've been mapping the SCAMT data to that geology and developing a model of what it looks like under the garbage rocks to the west. And what has emerged is the rift anticline, and it's about a 4.5 to 5 kilometer fold structure. It projects in a northwest-southeast direction. It's almost a dead ringer for the gold rush. In fact, they've, with the latest CSAMT lines that they did as part of this recent program, they've now come out and explicitly said this is a gold rush analog, a dead ringer. And I've looked at their presentation and that, and it says, wow, if they're right about the Wen Band 5 sitting there along that spine of this fold structure, and these fluids did come in from the west and blow through, and gold got hung up in these Wen Band 5 rocks, there's another potential gold rush here. But the problem is they can't drill it until they get a plan of operations. Since 2012, they've had three of these notice of intent permits, which allow you to disturb 5 acres with your drill hole pads. And they've exhausted that, and three is the limit for a project at the BLM grant. So they said you have to do a plan of operations for the whole project, and that'll allow you 100 acres of surface disturbance. And this can take 12 to 18 months to get. So they initiated that process late last year. It's going to cost them $400,000 U.S. to do all the environmental baseline studies, and they have to just cool their heels. But they think they can get this permit by October and then go in there with a 12 to 15 hole program to test this rift anticline target. And if this turns out to be another gold rush, it'll be ironic because it's just to the west of where Albert Matter and his team, spent $20 million plus, chasing the iceberg system, hoping that it would get a better grade, so there could be an open pitable, and then chasing the avocado under the gravels to the north, and then the higher grade Serena offset zone west. And then all the time, the monster deposit was offset to the west, buried underneath these rocks. And the reason they never poked a hole into it, because they always assumed that these basalts and volcanics would be 1,000 meters deep. And who wants to drill on a blind target there? But the one of the holes that the Charles Wheatley spotted in 2018, close to this area, it showed that it's actually not that thick. And when they did the CSAMT survey lines, they realized, oh, yes, this stuff is not that thick. So this target is within reach of a reasonable drill hole depth. And if they are right about the whole model, this is a major discovery waiting to happen in the last quarter of this year once they get permission to drill. And once they have this plan of operations, well, then they can just keep drilling because it's large enough that they can delineate this whole thing without having to pause again for more drill permit applications.
John, thanks a lot for the update.
You're welcome, Jim.
My guest has been John Kaiser, his website kaiserresearch.com. I'm Jim Goddard.
Comments made on Discovery Watch are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any manner whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Archived online at howstreet.com. Discovery Watch is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.